Hey folks, Rex Bear here with Leak Project. Hope you're all doing well wherever you are, whatever you're doing. We had a very interesting conversation today with Gerald Clark about a book that was released by Mauro Biglino titled The Book That Will Forever Change Our Ideas About the Bible, The God's Coming from Space. Now, Mr. Biglino was hired by the Vatican to translate ancient Hebrew documents of the Old Testament. His translations were done by publishing the exact and literal meaning of the phrase in Hebrew translated into English. Now, Mr. Biglino says the church and foundations of faith, a made-up credo which speaks of God who created the man with his own image and resemblance. Mr. Biglino also states multiple passages in the Bible clearly mention the presence of alien life and extraterrestrial intervention. Quoted in the original Hebrew language, followed by an accurate literal translation, word by word, which follows a graphic system immediately linking it to the original text, and it gives the reader direct access to the biblical text as well. Now, in his work, The Book That Will Forever Change Our Ideas About the Bible, The God's Coming from Space, he also breaks down a detailed timeline and orbit of Nibiru at 3,600-year cycles, just like Zachariah Sitchin, just like Gerald Clark, and many other whistleblowers that are out there today. Now, when you combine Mauro's work with Mr. Gerald Clark's hypothesis and then Zachariah Sitchin's work, and many others, it becomes more and more difficult to deny these possibilities of the Anunnaki being mankind's genetic manipulators. Now, in my opinion, that does not mean by any means they created our soul, but manipulated the vessel it resides. We also discussed Gerald's scroll of the genealogy of the gods. And the neat thing about this is we actually have video footage scrolling down showing how Gerald has connected multiple deities of different cultures and time frames together and has a certain name of an Anunnaki that has been translated from ancient texts. We also discuss many different texts combined with not just the Sumerian stuff, you guys. So there's a lot of different reference points here that I really appreciate. Now, Mr. Biglino is no layman or self-taught linguist as well. Here's an excerpt from his website. Mauro Biglino is an Italian scholar of religious studies for about 30 years. He has been researching the so-called sacred texts and the belief that only knowledge and direct analysis of the ancient writers' message can lead to true and profound understanding of the religious thought expressed by humanity. Now, the linguist and philosophical knowledge acquired through the study of Hebrew, Mesoteric manuscripts, as well as his knowledge of Latin and Greek, allowed Biglino to work as a translator for a San Paolo publishing, Vatican publishing house, actually, that eventually published 17 books from the Ancient Testament, including Biglino's interlinear literal translations from the Studegartensia Bible. So, quite the mouthful there, you guys, and I hope I was able to say all those words properly, especially being in radio. But anyway, enjoy the show, you guys. This is a great presentation, and I really like the way Gerald breaks this stuff down. He brings a lot of things to the table every time we speak with him. And make sure if you go to the website, GeraldClark77.com, to purchase any of his ebooks or good old-fashioned books that are actually autographed, many of them. A lot of really cool stuff at GeraldClark77.com. Also, check out this other website. If you're health conscious, if you like to eat healthy, if you're not a meat eater, or if you're thinking about becoming a vegetarian or even a vegan. A lot of people, when you hear the term vegan, they cringe because they think, man, I'm not going to get that steak. I'm not going to have any fun when I eat. Well, you should check out this website, artisticvegan.com. There's some incredible recipes, world-class recipes, actually, and just really appreciate everything Krista does. So talk to you guys soon. Enjoy the show. Be the change you want to see. A book called The Book That Will Forever Change our ideas about the Bible, the gods coming from space. Now, this information is so comparable to the stuff Gerald wrote about in his books that we're going to talk about this today in the comparison. So thanks a lot for joining us, Gerald. How the heck are you?
Hey, I'm doing really well, Rex. This individual came to my attention, Mauro Biglino, about a year ago. One of my fans sent me a PDF of his freely distributed book. He's an Italian guy, and he had written his original books for the Vatican in Italian. And he had a mission for himself to convert it to English, but it wasn't ready until about a year ago. So this PDF showed up in my email, and I took a look at it and realized that he was saying pretty much exactly the same thing. Same characters, same Genesis story, same Adam and Eve story, same Noah's flood story, involving the exact same characters that I'd researched in the Sumerian documents. And I found this fascinating, especially since he had started with a commission from the Vatican to go and translate these Maserite texts, these original Hebrew texts that did not and not add the vowels in there the way it was done when it was originally translated. They wanted it translated just using the consonants in the exact translation. And he was such a scholar that he included those Hebrew translations from the Maserite text in his book. And I thought that was pretty fascinating, especially when he landed pretty much the same exact story that I did. So a gentleman from Italy who'd been attending a lot of Mauro Biglino's conferences, which apparently he's doing several of them in Italian. Well, this individual said he'd attended all of his conferences and contacted me recently with the same book. And I said, yeah, I've already read that. I had actually sent it to my mom about a year ago because, you know, this kind of esoteric ancient knowledge is not for everyone. And my mom was still at the place where, you know, That's fine for you, but it doesn't apply to me. Well, so I really wasn't in a place where I could have dialogues with her about my books. And so I saw this book where he clearly had decoded these texts as a scholar on contract with the Vatican and was a published author for them on many other books. This was not his first one. And so I sent this English translation of this book, which is very much written for the lay populace, and I sent it to my mom, and I was hoping I'd open a dialogue with her to talk about where her belief system lands with what I'm writing about and that they're actually very, very similar. And it didn't really go anywhere, so I forgot about the book for a while. And just recently, a gentleman from Italy contacted me who I said was going to these conferences. He said, do you realize that he has this piece of the story that then puts the credence onto the Sumerian accounts, if you can prove those truth on all of this is true. And he held the other side of the story relative to the Bible. So when you put those two together and they're telling the same story, it's like, wow. So he encouraged me to make contact with Mr. Biglino. And so I decided to go listen to a few of his interviews, which he's got on YouTube now. One of them was with Jim Mars with an interpreter. And I think he did another one with a couple of ex-policemen who were running a radio show. I can't remember the name of the show off the top of my head, but they didn't have him on the show, but they had listened to a segment where he was interviewed and then did a commentary on the show. And so I feel like we're kind of doing that since we're not interviewing him. But he's written everything that he had to say in English now, so we have it available. So, you know, instead of going through the translator and slowing down with questions and dialogue that way and distracting from the material, I wanted to focus just on the material with you, Rex.
Well, and one thing I'd like to bring out to our audience here is the way that Mauro actually put together these translations is he started from the original Hebrew, the ancient text of the Old Testament. He takes the exact translation of what that letter is. There's clear passages in the Bible that talk about extraterrestrials and the Anunnaki in these translations, and it's quoted in the original Hebrew language. So it's the accurate, literal translation word by word, and it's using a unique and easy to follow graphic system that immediately links to the original text. This enables the reader to have direct access to the biblical text.
Yeah, exactly. So because of that, And because of that, and that nobody can go, oh, it's a mistranslation or anything like that anymore, apparently that story came to the forefront with the Vatican and realized what he was putting two and two together with this translation, and his contract was terminated. He'd already done, I think, 17 of the books when he was terminated. So after he was terminated, he decided this story's too important not to tell the people. And so I see him as a pretty brave hero stepping up against some pretty powerful forces and disclosing the truth the same way many others have done. But it just so happens when it is dealing with humanity's origins and the truth about who we are versus what these texts were converted to do, which was enslave a bunch of people into a belief system for control. And so once that came out, he was out of the picture, but that doesn't change what he said. And we have his words, and I think that's very powerful.
It is. And let me just read this passage actually from the book. This work stems from a careful analysis of the text, relying on the original meaning, consonant roots, which represent the basis of the Hebrew vocabulary, as published in the dictionaries of Biblical and Aramaic Hebrew used worldwide. So how do you debunk that? I mean, if it's the actual translation of the letter, is there any way to get around that?
No, not really. But actually, Mauro was a really smart guy. He realized that the story that he stumbled across was preceded by a long period of time in the Sumerian documents. Okay, so he turned out to be, in his book, you'll see, that he took what he learned from the Maserite texts in his translations, correlated it with the Sumerian cuneiform tablets, and came up with a story, not just a story, but a factual retelling of what it all means. That if you read his book and then read my first Anunnaki of Nibiru book, you'd have trouble distinguishing the part where I'm focusing on the Anunnaki. I mean, the exact same players, the exact same story. It is astounding how similar our stories are.
Well, and so, also you guys are very similar to Zachariah Sitchin and many others that have this same hypothesis. It's like you guys have almost worked in conjunction together.
Yeah, well, we worked in parallel. I didn't know anything about his work. I had written my book in 2013, and I found out about him afterwards. But apparently he'd been doing this kind of work for a very long time. It looks like he was born in September of 1950, so he's a little bit older than I am, too. But, for instance, if you want to turn to just to see the corroborations of what he said relative to the Bible versus what the Sumerian or ancient astronaut story is, according to Gerald Clark. Now, my story is quite similar to many others, but the level of detail that he uses is very satisfying. It reminds me of some of Sitchin's work, too. Very, very, very detailed.
Well, he says specifically that Nibiru is talked about, the Anunnaki are talked about. There's a 3,600-year orbit with Nibiru. I mean, that's all in these translations.
Yeah, do you want to maybe jump over to page 24 of his book and we can talk about that?
Sure.
I think if you start looking at the main stories, several hundred pages, this book. But when you get over to about page 24, he starts telling the seminal stories about Adam and Eve and Noah's flood and so on and so forth. Well, you don't have to stay there very long, but if you notice on the very first line, the word Enki and Enlil will show up, the two sons of Anu, and he mentions Anu in there. So all of a sudden, he starts connecting the Sumerian story with what he learned from the Hebrew story, and they make absolute sense to him. He sees the word Anunnaki as the Anakim that showed up in the original Hebrew. And so he did very much what Sitchin did, what I did, what many other people did, started from the Bible and then correlated that with what the Sumerian document said, and then added up, and all of a sudden the light comes on. When you see the original story, let's ask this question. How could the original story be a myth and the data that was derived from it be the fact? Understand?
Well, I mean,
that's the opposite.
How it works in the Twilight Zone, Gerald.
Well,
Mauro
brings this up in his book. He says, you know, that's just ridiculous. That's ludicrous. And, you know, and the fact is that he tells the same story about these beings being created by the Anunnaki in Africa while they were mining gold. Having a, you know, ending up not being able to procreate, then being able to procreate, showing up in front of Enki and Enlil in the Garden of Eden. It's all there from page 24. So I was like, wow, okay. Well, he either read my book or we're reading the same material, seeing the same thing. And I believe that's the case. Is when you do read the Sumerian documents, you'll see that the everything derived from it has its own interpretation and its slant and its audience it was written for and its particular purpose in terms of who was meant to be controlled by this information or influenced by it. Call it control if you want. So,
why would somebody that has that much knowledge, credentials, resume, etc., you know, the Vatican brings him in, he comes up with translations that they don't like, they kick him out, and now he comes out and basically releases this for people to read online even, because if this is true, and once again, Joel, I got to tell you, as compelling as this information is, and I can certainly say, wow, that could be it, I am still agnostic. I oftentimes think, man, maybe I'm in a tank somewhere like in the Matrix and I'm really just plugged into a VR set. I don't know. You know what I mean? I'm just...
Dude, you were born in Missouri. That's all.
Missouri.
Show me state. Yeah.
Show me state. I wasn't, but it is an amazing state. And, you know, so...
No, it's good. Listen, do I have any reservations with anything anyone's ever written? Absolutely. You don't have to agree with everything. The fact that he came to this story, though, and it so coincides with what the Hebrew text... Now, you have to realize, so what the Hebrew text mirror the Sumerian story? they were derived from it, so why wouldn't they, you know? But the fact that he translated it without the skewing that was done by adding the vowels that could easily change the nature, the meaning of the world, the words. And that's why he pointed that out so significantly in these little diagrams with the Hebrew text and his original translations there for you could see it.
Right.
So, you know, it's good to always keep your filter engaged. Let something hit you. And if it resonates with you, it's for you. If it doesn't, it probably wasn't for you. You know, and that's how we all are, you know.
Right. Right.
We all have our own issues in the world that are interesting to us. And what's interesting to us has to do with our personal path. So what's interesting to me may not be interesting to my mom. And I get that, you know, and everybody should get that. So but does it make it untrue because it cannot, you know, well, how much, you know, ultimately proof only comes from your verification of truth from within. That's it. You can't prove anything to anyone else. And for you, whatever level that is for you, whether it's never ever proof or that anything is ever true, but you have a moving dialogue that's moving toward your big picture of what you believe to be, feels the most comfortable, the most right at the time. And by the way, that changes with your life as new information starts filtering in. You may hold a position now that 10 years from now you'll think is ludicrous.
Absolutely. Yeah, things certainly change like that. If I go back 10 years where I was at 10 years ago, I would probably think now that I was the false prophet, you know? Absolutely. I mean, raised Christian and having a very Christian family that not fundamentalist by any means. I mean, we missed church a lot growing up. We would wear blue jeans going to church oftentimes. But, you know, just kind of having that mindset your whole life, believing in the New Testament being the literal words of God and Jesus coming down to heaven or from heaven to die for our sins. And then the more that I thought about it, I, you know, why would an all-knowing God create his son, bring him down to earth, have him sacrificed in a horrible way so that people's sins would be justified? I just, things like that, you start adding that up, plus all the just mistranslations and things that don't make sense. It really kind of took me off of that path. But other people, that's their path, and they would look at us as we're the people deceiving them. And they're right to their opinion. You know, I mean, it's a good thing we don't all think the same way because we'd be like the Borg. But if this is the truth, I certainly want to know the truth. And if that breaks the paradigm of my original thinking, then so be it. You know, it's the truth.
Yeah, exactly. Well, I read his words. I was actually a little concerned that the story was so close to mine that it was crazy. I mean, it kind of spooked me. So I'm still a little standoffish right now. But at the same time, when I go through and look at what he came up with and how he connected the dots, I think he did a great job. And I think he's right on the money. And that's why he got fired. So, you know, but that's me, you know. And as a matter of fact, just for the record, I'm going to try to reach out to him and bring his piece and my piece together, and we're going to see what happens.
You know, that'd be incredible.
That's how much I believe his story, just so you know where I'm at.
Well, and we've talked before the show. You feel that if you guys can get together, essentially this could be the foundation of change to where if this is the truth and if these – you know, here's one thing that people can say, though, about the translations. I'm just going to play devil's advocate here for a minute, Gerald. Let's say these translations that are 6,000 years old, just because they're that old, does that make them any less – right or wrong? I mean, couldn't you have National Enquirer 6,000 years ago just like you do today? Do you ever think about stuff like that?
Yeah, well, absolutely. Listen, I think they were actually doing namesake obscuration, smearing each other, blah, blah, blah. But that doesn't change. Even though you have lies mixed with truth, listen, your everyday reality since you've been born has been lies mixed with truth. Am I right? So why would it be any different in the past? Your job is to filter through that and see what makes it through your BS filter and resonates true with you to see if you can come up with a coherent picture that makes your life meaningful and things feel true to you. Okay, that doesn't mean they're absolutely true. There's always things you're not going to know.
Right.
Okay. So that's kind of how I view it.
Yeah, absolutely. And that's a real
What we do know. Here's what we can do as a scientist. When somebody 6,000 years ago writes about the construct of our solar system and how they believe it came to be, their cosmogony, which I'm talking about the Enuma Elish, by the way, and Mauro Biglino, Biglino, I think that's how you, Biglino.
Biglino without the G.
Biglino, yeah. He clearly read the Enuma Elish, which is the Babylonian epic of creation, talking about Nibiru, how it got trapped in our orbit. He actually summarizes it in the book. So he's very well informed. So the fact that he was that well informed while he was looking at the Maserite text, did it influence the way he converted it? I don't think so. But at the same time, listen, the Sumerians wrote everything down. They wrote down marriage contracts, rental agreements, bill of sale, you name it, hymns to the gods. I mean, we have hundreds of thousands of documents from these people. Okay. Now, here's the thing that I want you to also try your hat on. It's often portrayed that Sitchin was the one that did the translations. Well, guess what? We've had a digitization program that's being used on these tablets. I believe at this point in time, approximately 30,000 of them have been converted. It's not Sitchin doing it, okay? So for all you out there that are still trying to take an axe to Sitchin over his translation, get real. Okay, go do the research yourself. You can read it yourself. You can get a Sumerian dictionary and get the cuneiform text and download it to your computer and stop blaming someone else for you not knowing. That's the truth. Okay, so the fact is these things have been digitized using optical character recognition to convert them to the current understanding of what we have. Okay, there's so much data in there. And, you know, a lot of it's just worthless data, but when they focus on the King's List, you know, and the higher ups who had people that could read and write that were recording history and watching the stars, this stuff's profound when you read that. When they hold a council meeting and decide that they're going to produce a primitive worker to replace this one because there was revolt, and to use genetics to do it. Listen, we didn't even discover genetics until this century. How the hell did they know about that 6,000 years ago? You got to ask yourself some real obvious questions whenever there's disparities in what we think we know and what actually is known. Gold mines in Africa 100,000 years ago. Who was doing that? The Sumerians tell us who it was. Okay, so for years, the Sumerian story was so outlandish that all I heard people saying and doing was defending the Sumerian story, giving evidence after evidence. I got sick of it after a while, to be honest with you. It's like the Nibiru thing, okay? How much evidence do you need before you say, okay, that resonates with me or doesn't, and I got to keep iterating, get every piece of evidence, you know? There's a certain threshold where you take things for what they are and you deal with them, not acting in denial, looking for any way to discredit it over and over and over and over and over again. Okay, that's kind of a place where you're in denial and you're trying to ride the fence, and that's not the nature of the truth. It's not on the fence.
Are you with me? Oh yeah, absolutely.
Sorry, I got
on
my soapbox.
I'm absorbing what you're saying.
I know, I got on my soapbox a little bit, but I've been doing this for several years now, and I've watched, you know, how people deal with new information that doesn't fit their paradigm. And it's a form of, you know, I don't know, insecurity and inability to have a dialogue about something that is outside your scope of knowledge. And, you know, I just did this show, not just recently, talking about awareness and consciousness and all these kind of things, and very much it's controlled. Your awareness is very much controlled by the scope of consciousness that you are manifesting. And this is about your chakras. So if you're at a very low level and you get something that rocks your paradigm, makes your meaning threatened, look at how you respond to it. And it says a lot about the being, not about the information.
Have you read the Gnostic texts?
Yes, I have.
For example, there's the Secret Book of John. I think there's a different name for that book also. Where
he mentions that book, and Mauro Biglino actually goes over that book in detail in chapter 10.
That one really was a powerful book, in my opinion.
The book of John, especially, yes, exactly. And it always stuck out to me, too, in the New Testament, because he talked about first-person sensations as he described these events versus the others that were third-person. So they were very mystical and symbolic things in the Book of John that goes all the way back to the Hermetic and the Enochian knowledge that also Biglino talks about. You'll love chapter 10 where he connects it with Thoth. He talks about the nature of who actually started these and what's the real truth here. And he ends up basically talking about Yahweh and Thoth. Okay, this is Enlil and Ningxia, just like I've been saying. And I read this, and I was like, wow, you are so on it. He totally gets it.
Now, anyway, I'm not referring to the Book of John that's talked about in the New Testament. I'm referring to the one that was found in the Nag Hammadi treaties.
I know. Well, they have the same origins, what I'm telling you.
Okay. Fascinating.
Yeah, that's why that one is so mystical.
Okay. Now,
go ahead.
I was just going to say one thing that I thought was fascinating about that book, at least in the Nag Hammadi treaties that I had access to. I've got it in my library. I should bring it out here and make some quotes out of it. It talked about these archons that were essentially created when the main Yal-the-Both was created as the main archon. And then when Yal-the-Both was created, he thought, man, I'm God. I can do whatever I want. So he created these other archons in his image. And then they decided to create man. And then when they did so, they created Adam, and they realized that they made Adam just as powerful, if not more powerful, than they were, because they had the essence of the original divine spark of feminine. And then essentially the story goes, they got scared, so they tried to imprison him in the garden. They created Eve, and then one of the serpent came to Eve to try and give her knowledge, and the serpent wasn't looked at as the bad guy. And I'm wondering who Yal-the-Both is, and some of these other archons that are referred to in this text.
You know, actually, I tried to go down this archon path, and this is the Levant interpretation of the Anunnaki hierarchy, and they gave them different names, for instance. So I kind of saw that, and I was like, well, okay, that whole story that you just described is told in the Sumerian tablets with far better detail. Far better detail. So I'm like, okay, well, this clearly was derived from the original. So I didn't pay a lot of attention to it, but we're talking about the same beings. We're talking about Enki and Enlil in the Garden of Eden in the city near the city of Eridu, his temple city, the first one he built on this planet. If you read the Sumerian kings list, the very first city where kingship was lowered was to Eridu, his city. Okay, and they even name who the king was. So there's a lot of names that start showing up. And they cross over different cultures and different experiences. And what I found is when I dug into this very deeply, thanks for bringing up that genealogy table.
I put this
together when I first started trying to figure out who was who, because all these different names, like you just showed. Well, what if one of those beings had 12 different names? I mean, if you just started pulling on the thread and they were trying to hide it from you, imagine how long it would take you to figure out that that was the same being, all those 12 instances, if they wanted to hide it from you.
Right.
See what I'm saying? So what I did on my genealogy table, if you look in on there, I actually put several of their names on there. They're also known as names to try to help you get a context of who we're talking about. A lot of people know about Zeus and Poseidon in Greece, but they have no idea that they're the same being as Enki and Enlil. You see what I'm saying? If you just knew that, you go, oh, they could go from this culture to this culture? Well, let me do that for the rest of the Anunnaki table that's mentioned in the Atrahasis. See what I'm saying? And that's what a lot of us did. It's like if this being could be here in this culture and called by this name, yet he's got the exact same symbols and attributes from Sumeria over in Greece, how is that possible? Understand? Then he shows up, then they show up in Rome, and it keeps going on. So you're like, wait a second, is somebody just borrowing this symbol and pretending to be that being, or is this real? Okay, so that's one of the first things is to figure out and get good with is that these beings lived a long time and they were different names in different cultures.
One thing too you'll notice now even is the Pope has many symbols on the clothes that he wears, the hat, the robe. You see a lot of stuff in these churches. It's funny how many religions say don't use symbology, yet they're filled with symbology. And you look at these symbols and they go back to these Anunnaki that you're referring to, Enki, Enlil, etc. So it's
right.
Almost
why don't you go ahead and put your mouse over Enki and Enlil off that chart. So we got a place to start. Go ahead and roll your mouse up a little bit higher up. No, go up higher. You can see Anu and Antu right there, right in the middle. No, go down. Go down, down and to your right. There. Okay, so there's Anu and Antu. This is where the whole story starts, okay? Anu shows up in many of the documents. He shows up in the Epic of Gilgamesh. He shows up in the Atrahasis. And he shows up, and Mauro Biglino clearly identifies Anu as the father in the sky, okay? He was the highest member of the Anunnaki Council. And then you can see right below him, there are two boys and a girl. There's Enki that was born of Anu and Antu. And you can see all the names for him. Lord of the Earth and the Waters, the Great Shepherd, Prince of Eridu, He of the Sacred Eye, Nutamud, that's what he's called in the Enuma Elish. Ahura Mazda, that's what he was called in the land of Persia that was founded by his son, okay? Kem Zarathustra, that was his son, Ningxida. He was called Ea, Poseidon, Neptune, several different names, okay? So it's interesting, though, that Anu and Antu had him, and you can see that Antu is his wife. But when Anu had a kid with Ki, this is her other name is Arash. You can see that just to the right of Anu. That's why Enlil came into the picture, and he ended up being a problem for Enki because he was born of Anu and his half-sister Ki. So Enlil, you can see there, sandwiches the other person right in the middle, which is Ninhursag. And she is, so these are the three key players that show up in the Egyptian Book of the Dead. They show up in the creation account of mankind. And they show up all through these different documents in the Sumerian text. So there's Enki, Ninhursag, and Enlil. And they have lots of different names. She was called Ninma, Belit Ili, and several other names. But a lot of people, for some reason, want to confuse her with Inanna Hathor. They are not the same being. Okay, Ninhursag is the daughter of Anu and Ki, whereas Inanna is the granddaughter of Anu through Enlil's line. Okay, so we don't have to spend a lot of time with this, but I want people to start seeing all these different names. And if you just took Enki and Enlil by themselves and did a complete genealogy table of just their kids, it would be overwhelming how many kids they had.
Sure.
So I only put like their firstborn up here so you could see it. Now, Ninurta is shown underneath Enlil and Ninhursag. He was known as Apollo in Greece. Okay, so all of a sudden now you can start connecting these beings from the ancient Sumerian story back to all the other cultures. And I've done that many, many times. Okay? Mm-hmm.
Now, I wonder if these guys all have Rh negative blood.
That's a good question. There's lots of things we'd like to know about them. And you know what? We found Gilgamesh's grave, according to the BBC, in 2003. And there are pictures of him, press release, the whole thing. But I've never heard anything about the DNA analysis of Gilgamesh. You know, he was a very special king writing his epic where he was trying to find eternal life, right? Well, his DNA would be very, very interesting to look at because his mother was a full-blown goddess. Her name was Ninsun. And his father was a regular primitive worker human like us, even though he was, he got elevated to royalty. But from a genetic standpoint, he was a regular Homo sapiens sapien like you and I. Well, when they have an offspring like that, and the female is the full-blown Anunnaki, and then the man contributes his DNA, well, the mitochondrial DNA from the female is quite powerful. And so whenever you have that situation, they're either two-thirds or three-quarters considered full-blown Anunnaki, and it changes the attributes they have in terms of their lifespan and a lot of other things. So Gilgamesh would have been very, very interesting to study from a genetic standpoint, right?
Absolutely.
Anyway,
Yeah.
So those kind of things, you know, we have this. As a matter of fact, I'm sure they have bodies. They have the answers, but they're just not going to release it and tell us, because this whole hoax of a creation reality that we've been told is designed to basically marginalize you, not empower you, and keep you in line under the system. Okay, where the government's your god. That's kind of what's going on now, right?
Oh yeah, absolutely. They want you to do what they tell you to and live their lifestyle, and in the meantime they can be the aristocratic godlike beings that they want to be and go use all the resources and just pillage the earth, you know? I mean, that's their motto.
Yeah, well, I was going to say one other thing that Mauro Biglino did in terms of genealogy tables and timelines that really fascinated me. I believe it was on page 188, something like that. It was in the appendix where he took his timeline, and I'm sure that he studied Lawrence Gardner. I'm sure that he studied Zechariah Sitchin's timelines, but he did, you know, that's okay to do, but he added some new stuff to it in terms of who Abram was, where he was relative to this story. And I really like that, because remember that show I did with you where I said, instead of going down and talking about the flood story where, you know, we go off and deal with Atrahasis Noah having an encounter with his Anunnaki, let's go to the city of Ur. Remember we did that?
Oh, yeah, absolutely.
Well, this is why he did that, is exactly for that same reason, because Abram was from that city having an encounter with all these Anunnaki beings and his dad working for Enlil in his temple, Yahweh. And he pointed this out definitively, you know, even though I've done it how many times? Well, because he worked for the Vatican, people will listen to him. They won't listen to me. Right.
You've got a pretty good following, Gerald. I mean, there's many people that talk about your work. You've got best-selling books, and I would say you're pretty much a go-to source now when it comes to the Anunnaki and the translations.
Well, you know, I didn't start out learning to read cuneiform, and that doesn't mean that I haven't taken several words and converted them and checked this out and verified that. Anybody can do that. So it's not about that. What's about is the speed of translation using a digital mechanism that you can rely on. And, you know, there are electronic databases. Not all the texts are in there yet, but they're getting there. Okay. So that, you know, that was one of the reasons I used the University of Oxford's myths from Mesopotamia to talk about these three important stories. I see one of them there, the Enuma Elish, is showing up in Wikipedia right now that you talk about. Well, that document, I think we could do an entire show on that, just talking about how our solar system came into existence and the idea of this rogue planet going in retrograde orbit that now the whole YouTube community is focused on. Well, the Sumerians talked about this way back when. Okay, so and I think that's really, really fascinating. But that shows up in the Enuma Elish and explains scientifically how they believe it happened. Even though they told it as an allegory of a battle of planets, it makes a lot of sense now. And we couldn't really even understand some of this stuff until we got to the place where we were doing space exploration and understanding the kind of interactions between these planets that are essentially like billiard balls that bump into each other sometimes, you know. It's a part of creating bigger planets. They attract matter to themselves, and, you know, asteroids, comets blast into your surface. That material stays around, and your planet grows bigger. And if it gets big enough, it might turn into a sun, you know.
So that's how suns come to be then.
Yeah, exactly. So that's actually one of the guys who was talking about recently, and I can't remember his name. He was talking about the demotion of Pluto and why that occurred. And he went through and defined what the definition of a planet was. Round, orbits the sun, and has cleared all the debris in its particular area, meaning it's absorbed it on its surface and it's growing. It's in a stable state where it's not surrounded by, you know, rocks that are still accumulating on the surface or being cast off to let somebody else deal with it, right? So anyway, but I thought that was very interesting when he was talking about that. Thinking about, you know, how, and it was mentioned there were over 50 bodies ranging in size, some of them as big as the Earth, some bigger than the Earth, out in the Kuiper Belt. And I was like, wow, really? So because they haven't cleared the debris field, they don't call them planets.
Well, that's interesting. Even, I guess they wouldn't have access to be able to see them good enough, the telescopes.
They can see some of them, but anyway. So we're let's get back on track here. Keep correlating with what Mauro Biglino did. We probably don't have to go to it, but so right after we did the creation account where he talks about the Enuma Elish, we talked about the Adam and Eve story that came from him, and I thought it was very illuminating. Especially in terms of how this feminine aspect responded to an offering of higher consciousness. You know, imagine this female being in this biblical story of the Garden of Eden decided not to take the offering of this evil snake who was Enki, right? Who created him in the first place and was telling him the truth. Imagine she had not eaten of the plant of the knowledge of good and evil, or whatever the symbolic thing was that led to higher consciousness. Imagine they hadn't done that. Where would you be now?
Be gold
still
mining.
Naked, still naked and enslaved, drinking gold out of puddles mining. Like an animal. That's how Enlil wanted them.
Hey, man, there's 80% of the population is doing that right now, man. Have you seen Naked and Afraid on TV? That's the new thing, man.
Well, no, I have not seen that.
Idiocracy at its finest.
Well, if they bring that show out and then follow it up with a Flat Earth series show so we can go ahead and rebury Isaac Newton for talking about these kind of things, we're on the right track to ascending in knowledge, aren't we? This is great. Yeah, the movie Idiocracy comes to mind. Yeah, I think this is a test to see, you know, to show us all that knowledge is not necessarily a linear process, that you could create disinformation to the point where people are completely just talking gibberish. And whoever's running the game in the simulation must be laughing their butts off.
Yeah, who is running the game?
Well, I think the top level. Wait, we're getting esoteric now. At the top level, if you've gone through my Emerald Tablets and all my writings, I believe the creator of all is running the top level holographic simulation. And this being owns the rules of the law of creation of time and the laws of creation of matter. And the rest of us are just agents in the simulator, programs, if you will, that are allowed to have an experience of the true providence of the creator of all once you go through some evolutionary process so that you've earned the right to represent a co-creative force. I think it's something like that. So then there are a lot of stages, a lot of levels, a lot of dimensions, and it's going on all over the galaxies. You know, it's not just here. Everybody's playing the same game, evolution of consciousness, to try to get back to the highest state of the manifestation of your true source essence, which is light, by the way, which does not require a body. So I find it very interesting, the idea of an avatar. Mauro doesn't talk about these esoteric energy and matter and things that I get into as an electrical engineer, because he was a linguist and a translator. But I still see pretty much everything that he wrote as very – I actually did not see – any contradiction yet in what he's written with what I came up with. Isn't that amazing?
It is amazing. Absolutely. Well, especially for such a controversial topic.
Yeah, and he added to the story. Well, I was mentioning back on his timeline that he put together starting 450,000 years ago in his appendix. And he comes out and says, you know, this is not exact. This is my interpretation of what happened. Okay? It's kind of like Sitchin writing the Lost Book of Enki. He didn't give you the source material. But he gave you enough justification from all his other books so that he put the story together. It had credentials. Well, he did the same thing with his timeline. And I want you to read that part. All of the listeners that are listening to this, go read the part where he's talking about the city of Ur and Nippur, where Enlil had his headquarters, and what Abram and his father and how they interacted. Because the reason that's so important, he ended up being the progenitor of the three world's religions. And when you find out the true story about the source of it all right there in the city of Ur, it ought to make you sit down and ponder what you truly believe, because it exposes the whole idea. We've got an Anunnaki ancient astronaut on a council who's in a temple, who's promoted himself as God, and he's got his liaisons running the city. How much more do you need? It's in stone. You with me?
Oh, yeah. I was thinking of the Georgia Guidestones when you brought up it's in stone, and I thought to myself, those people that erected those Georgia Guidestones did it in stone as a subliminal message to the masses. It's written in stone to kind of push their occult agenda. And I wonder, you know, if we're going to go kind of off the beaten path here for a second.
Yeah,
Enlil that actually said, hey, man, make these, you know, 500 million people, but no more than that. Have all these rules and laws. I mean, do you think, because that's a very mystical, occult monument, and the people that put that together are very mystical and in the know. So a lot of people think at the very top levels, some mystery schools and secret societies know what you're talking about by the time they get to a certain level or degree.
I think what you're seeing there is the alien contract that was done with the military-industrial complex, setting out the constraints for if we do this for you and give you all this, this is what you're going to do for us, and this is the timetable. This is the clock right here in stone that this must happen. And everybody who signed up to, Adam Weishaupt and beyond is signed up to that. Or they wouldn't be there. That's how the rule. That's how the game is set up. So I believe it could. It had to be a very high-ranking Anunnaki. It looks like it was the Illuminati. That's who they're venerating. And at that level, at the height of that pyramid, there were only three or four beings that it could be. And I just showed you the genealogy table of the two highest-ranking ones that were here. It was Enki and Enlil, and then Nin Hartzog. Those were very high-ranking beings. And then they changed ranks over time in each zodiacal house, so it's hard to keep track of them. But at the time all this stuff went down, for that to happen, it had to be Anu, Enki, or Enlil. Now, I want to bring something to your attention, talking about the gods, these Anunnaki beings making decisions about whether we live or die. I'll give you a couple of instances of that. And I've done this many times, but I'm going to do it again for you while we're talking about the Enuma Elish and the Atrahasis. The Atrahasis was another name for Noah. Well, after 600 years in the Bible, Noah was the king when the flood came, right? Anybody can go look at this in Genesis. Okay. Well, now you go read the Sumerian documents. In my first book, I pointed out exactly what they said after Enlil got upset about how many humans there were that had been produced by his half-brother with his DNA. And by the way, in the Adam and Eve story, you'll see that Mauro Biglino also believed, just as I did, that Enlil did not know genetically what he had done. That's part of the reason he was probably there observing, it's trying to figure it out. Right?
That makes sense. Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. And so he did it without his approval, essentially. He gave us knowledge and an energy body and all these constructs so that we could have an evolved consciousness experience and be like they were. And that's what pissed Enlil off so badly. So Enki did that, along with his half-sister, Ninma. Anyway, well, after a while, if you go through the records, you'll see that Enlil was bringing these slaves from Africa that Enki produced up to Mesopotamia to help him with his projects. And there's a description in the Atrahasis where he's describing them like animals drinking out of puddles. And they're making all kinds of racket, keeping him up at night. Does this sound like a disincarnated spirit to you or an actual physical biological being that the people are having encounters with and clothing? And he's pissed off about the noise from these beings that are bellowing like bulls. That's what he said. Maybe they were protesting like they are now all over the world, bellowing like bulls in the street, right? Who knows?
Could be, yeah.
Well, in the Sumerian document, he says exactly after 600 years, the same time Noah was the king in the city of Sharupak when the flood came, is when he started his onslaught of trying to get rid of the humans, using disease, using cutting off the food, the water, probably energy weapons to prevent the rain, just like we're doing right now in their various areas. Look at Africa, what's going on with the weather. It's very, very terrible what's happening to those poor people.
Africa seems to be the worst place in many countries out there to kind of go through this simulation that you call it. And I often wonder why. Maybe because you said Enki, that was his originally, and because he conflicted with Enlil, then they've kind of made that a hot zone? I don't know.
That's exactly why. You're exactly right. So all of the terrible evils that are going on in Africa, I believe they're directed toward Enki himself or his clan. Now, it looks like Marduk has been down in Africa as well recently, and I did a show on that where he, you know, that's where the gold is. So if you want to be the ruler on planet Earth, you got to control all the gold, right?
You think the gold gets shipped off those guys? I remember one time a couple years ago when I used to be a real avid blogger, I put this blog together saying, where did all the gold go? Because a lot of the gold, according to many of these articles that come out in Fort Knox, isn't there. You know, it's tungsten-filled, gold-plated bars, and China's came out in many articles saying that the stuff that they thought was supposed to be gold given back to them isn't actually gold. And I think to myself, wow, well, if the Anunnaki really is in power, if they're the Illuminati, I guess, at the top levels, and if gold is that powerful, then why would they stop? I mean, now they've just got a more intelligent slave class to get their gold.
You're exactly right. Doesn't matter. Now, let's play a little imaginary game. Remember the show we did where we were talking about the Swiss tunnel opening and all the symbolism of a portal and beings coming through?
The ritual deaths, yeah. The mock sacrifices.
Well,
oh, yeah.
There's a lot to that, and I've been thinking a lot about that. Do you realize that there are people working at CERN that for some time now, some have left and written things, and I'm not going to name any names. It's probably very dangerous. Who are describing that once they took it up to a 40 terabolt range with the electricity, that they were actually opening a wormhole, and they started out by sending things through, and then one of the workers there went through and then came back, and I'm like, what? So if you had the ability to open a portal in space-time so that you could, or a wormhole where you could go from point A to point B, what could you do with that would be extremely useful? Well, imagine you had a very precious metal in large quantities that you wanted to get from point A to point B, and the idea of using rocketry to try to lift that kind of weight isn't really an option anymore because there's so much. Imagine you built a portal where you could drive an entire truck into a Swiss tunnel full of gold, take it into a reactor that's set up surrounding your pathway that you're driving on, okay, and that they could take the entire payload right then and there over to another planet. You tell me that isn't something that would be on level with what the Anunnaki could achieve. Now, here, I want you to think about something. Remember that movie Contact with Jodie Foster?
Oh, yeah, I watched it the other day.
Where they were making an allusion to the ability to do exactly what we just described, create a portal through all space-time where you could go to wherever you wanted to. And this counter-rotating magnetic gyro was the key to this, right? Right? You remember they had one of them got destroyed and then Japan had the other one. Well, imagine you had built something like that underground so that nobody saw it and you could be doing those kind of things.
Well, another thing, too, that I've often wondered about CERN is if it can create a wormhole-type technology, you could put in a payload of anything. You know, you could be a missile, it could be a bomb, it could be gold, it could be
a biological agent.
Game over, man.
Well, that's exactly right. If you were an advanced race and you had to move large amounts of supplies from one place to another, how would you do it? And I'm talking really large, you know, not something that could be put on a Delta IV rocket. I mean, something really massive. Well, you may be able to, if you had a portal like that where you could drive whole semi-trailer trucks full of stuff in, you could just have them, you know, put a whole fleet in, send them. You see what I'm saying? So if you could couple it with a tunnel system, I think it would be a very clever way to expedite getting all the resources off the planet, out of somebody's sight, underground, where nobody can see it happening, and bye-bye. I really think that's what's happening, and I think that tunnel ceremony had something to do with that. And it's very similar to what's going on at CERN, but except just adjust the configuration so that a truck could drive in there versus what they're doing on that level. You see what I'm saying?
Well, I mean, and think about being able to create black holes. And that's better than any missile system also. So the defense systems, et cetera. You know, but if we're going to go on this path of possibilities of there just being a few key players, and you've mentioned them, well, okay. So this entire world is almost like the movie Jupiter Ascending meets The Matrix, in a sense.
That's exactly right. I actually like both of those movies. And you have to mix in the gods of Egypt in there, too, because the reality is these beings are from another dimension. they can take on different forms and different material forms that you and I can. So they could appear as a regular human. You'd never be able to distinguish them from someone else. Or they could appear, you know, at some other chimeric body if they wanted to.
Let me ask you this, Gerald, before I forget. There's the images of these Anunnaki gods that we see that have the wings, the different animal body parts, etc. Is that literal translations of these guys? And also, what about the reptilian phenomenon? I mean, do you think that there are shape-shifting reptilians? Are they Anunnaki? There's some old school stuff, man. I've seen some 9,000-year-old statues of these 8-foot-tall lizard men.
No, there are many, many races in the galaxy, okay? And if you just listen to Paul Hellyer, he tells you there were definitively 4 here, up to 20, okay, that have been here for thousands of years. So absolutely there are different beings that look different than we do from other places, and they've been here. So now, I just told you that. Imagine you were a being, you could change any shape you want. Hey, I want to be an ibis-headed human for this week, and next week I'm going to be a winged dragon. Well, imagine you could do that. Whatever material form that the avatar wants to take on, they can. So I think those things, those chimeras, that were real. And I think they also produced several genetic offspring in the process of trying to create a primitive worker, where they used animal DNA. They tried a lot of different things in mixing to come up with some entity. Oh, there you go. I'm glad you went to that timeline. And if you scroll down to about, I don't know, the time of Abram, about 3800 BC or so, you'll start to see, or 1600 BC, when you get in that region and start to see the detail that he went into as a religious translation authority. He clearly meant as much to him as it did to me, because he added massive amounts of detail about the city of Ur in that region. And I thought that was really, really fantastic, because I actually went out and got a separate book on Abram and Abraham and read everything I could to find out about.
This is interesting.
Noah's
70,000 years ago.
Yeah. Well, he's not new. Listen, he supposedly was 600 when the flood came, right?
So that means the flood was 69,400 years ago then, or?
Well, there were different floods, okay? There were at least 4 major ones and multiple minor ones, okay? This is his estimation, okay? That doesn't mean it's right. But he's trying to put it all together because, listen, Noah existed prior to the flood happening by a long period of time. And actually, I believe that Noah was actually his actual flood came around the end of the last ice age, okay? He probably aged just like the Anunnaki did. When you look at some of their accounts, hell, some of them served for 28,000 years, okay, by themselves. And that wasn't how long they lived. That's how long they served. So this is the original genetics, I believe, from the pre-flood of the Sumerian kings list. All of them lived that long. So I think there was some probably tweakage that went on after the flood to limit the human populace. Because if everybody lived that long, imagine how big the populace could be.
And right? It'd be crazy. And they're really, maybe that's why they want to limit it to 500 million people. So those 500 million that they choose, they can give them lifespans of 100,000 Earth years.
That's possible. I mean, if you're a dedicated worker to these higher level echelon Anunnaki, guess what happened to Noah when they discovered him? He was actually born 50%. Anunnaki DNA, since his father was Enki and his mother was a primitive worker, a regular human, I should say that, instead of primitive worker, and her name was Batan.
Way to go, Gerald.
He didn't get the mitochondrial DNA that Gilgamesh did. And then in the Epic of Gilgamesh, if you read that story, Gilgamesh seeks out this being who is he calls him Utnapishtim. Okay, that's his name for Noah in his culture at the time. Now, we know he had many other names. Utnapishtim, Zeusudra, and Atrahasis were just other names for Noah. Well, he sought this guy out because he knew his DNA was more virile than Noah's DNA, because he was only 50%, and Gilgamesh knew he was at least 2/3 because of his mother Ninsun was a full-blown Anunnaki goddess. And when he found out, as the king of Uruk, that the king of Shurupak got eternal life after the flood, He wanted that for himself. And that's one of the key stories about Noah, is he was given eternal life. And I don't think a lot of people realize that. by Enlil and Enki when they were present, when they discovered him.
And this is talked about in the Epic of Gilgamesh.
Actually, no, that's in the Atrahasis tablets. You'll read that. And I think it's in tablet 11,
okay.
where finally Enlil and all his clan had taken off into their low Earth orbiting craft, and they were surveying the flood damage after this flood came that he asked his brother Poseidon Enki to bring, which he didn't. But apparently Nibiru's passage looks like it was responsible for causing it. And they had sworn an oath not to tell anybody because they wanted them all dead, or Enlil did. And many of these council members didn't agree with that oath.
How do you spell that? Sorry to interrupt. The tablet?
Atrahasis?
Yeah.
A-T-R-A.
Okay.
A-T-R-A-H-A-S-I-S. It's actually on display in, I believe it's the museum in London.
Okay. Sorry to interrupt. I just wanted to.
Yeah, I believe it's in the British Museum, or this one is in the University of Philadelphia. I'll have to look. When you get down to the actual samples, you may be able to tell.
Okay.
But yeah, this is a very good story, and especially the one I took from the University of Oxford with Stephanie Dolly. It was just because she did a lot of analysis of the name Atrahasis and connected it with many other stories, but it's such a famous story. Okay. Well, when you find out that Atrahasis was Noah and that the reason that Gilgamesh was coming to see him was he wanted the secrets to eternal life that he got. And that whole story is really fascinating. Clearly, something about Gilgamesh as the king, he found this prickly seaweed, it seemed like, that was growing in the shallow oceans that Utnapishtim or Noah told him about. And Gilgamesh got this and was heading back to the city of Uruk when he had an encounter with, it looks like symbolically, Enki that took it away from him. So they did not want him to have eternal life, and they prevented it from happening, even though he found the concoction that they were using to make their elixir of some sort.
You think there was gold in that elixir, some type of monatomic
gold? Well, it's interesting. In the Adapa tale, Anu offers the first Adam, the Adapa, three different things. He offers him the food of life, the elixir of life, or the bread of life, the elixir of life, and then some sort of oil that he's supposed to rub on himself. So there's a drink that they're drinking and some sort of bread that they're taking. And I believe this bread has a lot to do with the same bread that is described in Hathor's temple on Mount Sarabit El Kadim, which is Mount Sinai. Okay, we found Hathor's temple there, and Lawrence Gardner clearly exposed that they had found massive amounts of this white talcum-like powder that they were not sure what it was until they figured out it was a byproduct of smelting gold with stibium. This is your famed starfire gold that the elite were making into conical bread cakes that was shown on the temple walls, and the ritual attendants were consuming this stuff. Well, this is the starfire gold that got disclosed to the world what they were doing to change their lifespans, change their mental processes, whatever they were doing. Because a monoatomic element, when consumed, is a superconductor. Now imagine what that must do to your neural processes.
And you also offer something like that or similar to that on your website, don't you?
Yeah, when I first found out about this stuff, I was fascinated that apparently the Anunnaki were aging on the Earth and that they were not comfortable with that aging rapid process that they were experiencing versus, you know, if they were in a 3,600-year orbit, that's how they used to age relative to us. And that's a weird thing to think about, that your age has to do with the orbital diameter of your planet around the sun. How weird is that? Okay, but that's what they're saying. So the idea that this elixir, this mixture of talcum-like powder that was derived from gold could have any effect on your body, I was really fascinated by this. So I looked into it pretty heavily. Read David Hudson's patent. He was a guy who discovered it here in the United States. And then he didn't really foreign file his patent. Actually, he was out of Europe. He didn't foreign file his patent, so a bunch of people discovered this patent, started reading the secrets of it, and then came up with the same, if not more efficient, ways to get a monoatomic element from derived from a transition metal. Okay, and then all the transition metals, the heavy metals, actually you can produce this from. I think there are six different ones, including silver and gold and platinum and iridium and rhodium and all and that whole platinum group. Okay, so people started doing this, and they learned the secrets of alchemy on how to produce this several years ago. well, much to do with the disclosure from Lawrence Gardner and also from David Hudson's patent. So I studied this patent, got really interested, realized I could make this myself. But before I did that, we did that, and then we realized that while we were on travel so much, it was very hard to get these kind of products stocked on a shelf and keep them there as people wanted them. So finally, we worked very closely with an alchemist after I got to know him, a Berkeley graduate, really bright guy, who clearly shared the same ideas about evolution of consciousness and the relationship to the truth that I did. And so we down selected him to help us make it, and we've been doing that ever since.
Now,
but it's our private label, and it's actually Krista's product, so she kind of heads those up.
Do you take that stuff on a regular basis?
Yeah, and I used to tell people, you know, don't go jacking yourself up on Starfire Gold thinking you're going to arrive to enlightenment just by doing that alone. It's going to...
Okay. I love it, man. I can see God.
But it is a very, very effective way to help you start distinguishing your natural energy from what's possible, because when you take a monoatomic like this, it has definite effects, and you may not feel them right away, but over a short period of time, it could, if you take too much of it, for instance. I can't even imagine eating an entire bread cake made out of Starfire Gold. This is like eating a philosopher's stone, okay? It's the same thing, by the way. Alchemists have known this for a very long time, too, that the effect of taking this stuff seems to trigger the alchemical process that's represented by Alchem, who is Thoth, in his caduceus. It triggers a change in the state of the body energetically. And this, it may trigger heightened chakra functioning and all kinds of things. What I see happening is it very much, for people who pay attention to how they feel, especially people who are doing yoga and eating well, when they take this stuff, it practically gives them an out-of-body experience, okay? it's like, it's pretty intense. Other people that don't pay attention to that, they don't feel anything. But the people that it does affect, they usually, if they take too much, for instance, we'll talk about dosing. If you take more than 6 drops a day of a single monoatomic element, you might be exceeding it, and it might start affecting your sleep, and you'll probably start noticing you've got a stack of books next to your bed that you're experiencing a syndrome we call hermeticism. Okay, so you got yourself wound up a little too much. Okay, so it's good to notice that and back off your dosage, because it can make you pretty, I don't know, kind of like very excitable about everything, if you know what I'm saying.
Just makes you more wanting to learn and understand things, you would say?
Yeah, but it does it at a mental level, like you were taking an energy drink, you know. And it's not short-lived. It lasts for a while. And we usually put like 6 drops of the M1. That's one monoatomic element, okay, as a source in our coffee, 6 drops in the morning, and sometimes more if we're doing a show. And then if you take it too close to bed, though, watch out, because it can affect sleep. But
it's
an amazing
dreams?
Thing. Very heightened mental activity, including alternative brainwave experiences and dreams. Absolutely. So, you know, it's like a superconductor is just that. It makes the resistance to electricity very almost minimum. It's a lossless system. So all of a sudden you do that to all your neurons inside your brain, all your electrical conduction ganglia that are related to your chakras. When you do that, it very much heightens your sense of energy, okay? And you can't explain that to somebody, but when they feel it, they know it, okay? So these products sell very well. Actually, Krista has difficulty sometimes keeping them in stock, but there's so many testimonials on these products. And, you know, she has other ones, too, that she's always working on different ones. And, you know, Krista's funny. She's an alchemist with food. So, you know, you look at these products and go, well, how do these make you feel? Well, she does the same thing experimenting with food to see how it makes you feel. And that's ultimately how we ended up being vegan. We were both vegetarian when we met. And I think it was about 2008 or 2009.
Now, what is her website?
Her website's artisticvegan.com. Yeah. And Yeah, artisticvegan.com. And she just actually got picked up today by Shape Magazine, that's going to start carrying some of her blogs. And she blogs practically every day, putting out different vegan solutions. And she talks about alchemy sometimes. But I would like to see her talk more about alchemy and the actual transformative effects that a vegan diet can have. We're disease-free. We don't have any problems. We feel great. Take absolutely no medications. And that's accessible, I think, to everyone if they would just give it a try. Because there's a lot of disease and hormones and things in processed food and meats and fish and dairy and all that kind of stuff that you may not have any idea about. So until you experience not having it, you don't know what you're missing. So
I'll tell you, man, that what she's got on the website, these dishes look absolutely fantastic, and they also look extremely good for you. I'm looking at the vegetable fried rice now.
Yeah,
and it's making me hungry.
Yeah, it's funny. It's funny. People can go on the blog. They can figure out what I'm having three times a day because she's so prolific. And she actually started doing some videos, too, on her YouTube channel.
Oh, that's great. Now, is it the same artistic vegan on YouTube as well?
I think it's Krista Clark is how it comes up. You can look up Artistic Vegan or Krista Clark, and she comes up on YouTube.
Awesome.
Yeah. But she just did. Oh, this one. This one is the one that just ended up in Shape Magazine. These wonderful little, she calls them hand pies. Imagine having something like that where there's no gluten in the flour. The flour is good for you. It's full of protein. It's got natural fruit inside with no sugar added. And these things are the bomb. The problem is keeping them around the house when she makes stuff like this, So
it looks delicious.
Yeah. So you can, when you tell somebody you're vegan and all they can think about is, well, what kind of salad do you have? I mean, good grief. I mean, use your imagination a little bit. She's got hundreds and hundreds and hundreds of different solutions for people. I actually love the way we eat. I don't talk about it very much, but I'm very lucky to have somebody like Krista that makes sure she pays attention to what we're eating and how it affects our energy body. So
that's awesome, and certainly it'll make a difference if you eat good, healthy, quality of life. You'll feel better, sleep better, have more energy. Mentally, you'll be more astute and on par with
things
that are going on around you.
Exactly, and that's actually why I just did my latest show. I did it on the human antenna, consciousness, and energy. And the reason I did that is exactly this. When you start doing things, you don't have to do it all at once. When you start doing things that affect your energy and you pay attention to that, that's how you're going to get to the highest place in this evolution of consciousness game, is by understanding that is the game and that you can play. Yeah, it's that first one that's got the little chart on it down below there, Rex. You got it. Under Seventh Planet Broadcasting. So that show right there I just did, I actually showed some of the effects of your structure, and I have an imaging system that I used to use called poly. Yeah, right there at that point right there, I've actually got images of Krista before and after her structure work and how this all relates to the human energy. It's all connected, and we can be a lot more responsible for how far we take that energy than what we've been taught in culture. Okay, so just learning what gravity is and learning to integrate it with it in your body can have a massive effect on what energy you feel. So I went over that and the equations of that. I know we've talked a little bit about that before, but so I did that show specifically for that reason. So I hope everybody watches that. It's very different than the Anunnaki of Nibiru stuff that I bring, but believe it or not, these slides came from part of them came from a conference I did down in Chichen Itza last year. And there's so much good information in the conference that I've done that I haven't really shared. So I'm going to probably start sharing some of that as well. So thanks for going to the web or the YouTube channel, Rex, and showing that. I appreciate that.
Oh, absolutely. My pleasure. It's great to have you on the show. Every time you come on, you just really every single time, man, you never get boring, Gerald. I find that pretty awesome.
All right. Well, let's try to keep it interesting then, because if we're getting the place where we're boring each other, then we need to take more time apart and gather more data before we share. Right. That's all.
Absolutely, man. I agree 100%. So, this is great. I would recommend our listeners go to GeraldClark77.com. Also, if you want to get access to some of this amazing work, make sure to use the discount Leak Project under the storefront. Now, Gerald, before we close out tonight, man, is there anything that I missed or should have asked that I didn't in regards to this connection of what Mauro Biglino put together and your works in relations to the Anunnaki and Nibiru?
Well, I think maybe just doing a summary conclusion of what we were attempting to do and what we found might be helpful. He used source documents, some of which I didn't use. He used the Maserite text, but also used the Sumerian documents. I've obviously been looking at all the versions of the Bible. I've read the Quran. I've read many of the supplemental books from various religions on what they believe to be true. And the fact that we come from two different cultures, he speaks a different language, and that we arrived at the same answer, at, you know, pretty much in the same time frame, which is interesting in and of itself, that we came up, you know, that we're right. Within a very close proximity. I think those kind of synchronicities are meant for, you know, our past to notice that. But what I would say is that I don't want people to hear new information through a filter that causes them automatically to become repulsed by it. Because if it challenges you and you build up resistance, that doesn't mean you have to accept it, but you at least need to be a good enough student to put your eyes on it and make a informed choice about where your path is going. Right. And as far as I'm concerned, I'm only interested in going to a higher path, the highest place that we can go. As a, you know, it's like the army taught us, be all you can be in this avatar body. So that's what, you know, and that goes for the truth, too, because, listen, you're only limited in this life by what you're willing to learn. I learned that a long time ago. If you're learning to learn something and get a new skill, then you can be you can have a different role. And that's true with information as well at the very highest levels. You can have a different role as an avatar relative to what you know to be true, so you can focus on the things that are very, very important, that are eternal, that are infinite, versus worrying about materialism and what's on TV and who's playing the next sports game. Right? That doesn't mean you can't enjoy that, but that shouldn't be your primary focus.
Absolutely. You know, one of my favorite songs, and it makes so much sense, it was written by Trent Reznor, and then I think Johnny Cash did a version after. It goes, "You could have it all, my empires of dirt. I will let you down. I will make you hurt." And those words still cause the hair on my arms to stand up, because it reminds me of this plastic world, this fake reality that we live in, where people strive to be great with their Rolls Royce, Mercedes Benz, Bentley, Ferrari, whatever. And that's all awesome. I'd love to have all that stuff too. But there's really no balance anymore with many people. And I think that you're doing a good job bringing that out, you know, helping people realize there are options and alternatives to what they've been force-fed their whole life.
Yeah, I wanted to bring up one last thought I just had. As a result of me doing this show, talking about human energy and pointing out the attributes that clearly the creator of all, and probably some geneticists that came after him, did for us, I was basically given a discussion comment that I'm really tired of people trying to be God. And I thought about that for a moment. I was like, wow, really? There's a difference between having an instance of an energy source from the creator of all, such that you become what you can become. You know, what you were created to become was an archetype. Become that. That doesn't mean you're replacing the being that created you. That just means you've gotten to a place where you realize you're an instance of that creator, and you then venerate them. So how that got misconstrued to see that, and what, and in general, what I'm saying is, the idea that for us to be all that we can be, and that somehow that we're promoting ourselves as the creator of all, that's ludicrous. That's ludicrous, and that's the kind of stuff that's being said in discussion boards. And I just want to put a fork in that right now. That's absurd. So be all you can be is what I'm telling you. That doesn't mean that you're the creator of all, but you are certainly an instance of the creator of all. And the expectation is that you should animate that. So work toward perfection. That doesn't mean you'll ever get there, but that should be your goal.
Or stay suppressed and continue to feel that if you can think outside of your typical senses, then it's something evil or demonic. And, you know, hey, that's cool too, right? I mean, it's
whatever people want to do. It comes down to responsibility for information. Some people won't take responsibility for their finances, so they'll farm that out to an accountant. Some people won't take responsibility for finding the meaning of life, and they'll farm that out to the current priests of society, the physicists and the scientists, or the government, or their old favorite, religious leaders. Well, first of all, I just want to tell everyone that you individually are responsible for your reality and finding your meaning. It's unique to you. So the fact that you go and join a group and try and do it, you've already screwed up. You've already screwed up. That doesn't mean you can't share with a group, but they are not the source of you finding your meaning. You are. So get busy. Know thyself. That's what it's all about.
Right on. Absolutely. Know thyself. Well said, Gerald. Appreciate you coming on the show. Folks.
Okay, brother.
Hey, thank you so much. And folks, pick up your copy of The Seventh Planet, Mercury Rising. Check out the latest episode of Seventh Planet Broadcasting, GeraldClark77.com. Also, don't forget to go to leakproject.com, become a contributing member. You'll have access to commercial-free podcasts, over 200 of them. You can upload one. You can upload all of them. It's up to you. Be the change you want to see, folks. This is Rex Bear. Talk to you soon.